Ingenious baby.
Today we're here with Spencer Doman, grandson of famous child development expert Glen Doman, who authored How to Teach Your Baby to Read and How to Teach Your Baby Math. He will talk about why you should teach math at an early age and provide tips on how to teach these basic math skills at home.
I wanted to talk to you because when I had my first child, I ran across your grandfather, Glen Doman, and some of his how-to books, and I thought it was really fascinating.
Yeah, sure. So I grew up in a very interesting setting. So my grandfather wrote a series of books, which he's probably most famous for, all about child development. Books like How to Teach Your Baby to Read, How to Teach Your Baby Math.
I'd say the Doman Method is a system of different programs and activities that can be done with young children to boost brain development and just the child's overall development. The first 6 years of life are the most important years in child development, because our brain during that period, our brains are developing at an incredible rate that will never be replicated again during our lifetime. And the baby's brain and the young child's brain is created to take in information from the environment at an incredible rate, right? We learn so much faster during the first years of life. And if anyone wants like a good example of how this works, you know, look at how young children learn.
I thought it was really interesting the way that you were teaching math. Can you talk about that a little bit, how you introduce a young child to math?
Yeah. So before we teach a child about how we write numbers, right? So if I say the number four to most people, they will imagine the way we write the number four, right? Mm-hmm. But the actual reality of the quantity four is this, right? Mm-hmm. And so what we actually do with young children is we teach the child quantities before getting into teaching them the numerical symbols. And this is very important because quantities are mathematical truth. And tiny children, even when they're babies, have the ability actually to see quantity and recognize them. Duke University did some amazing research where they took six-month-olds and they essentially showed those six-month-olds quantities. And what they found is if they took a six-month-old and they showed them two screens, right? One screen with the same quantity shown over and over and over again, but in different patterns. And then on the other screen, they showed differing quantities. They found that the six-month-olds were more interested in the changing quantities, which basically meant that even at 6 months of age, children can see when a quantity is changing and when it's staying the same. And so this ability is called innate number sense. And Duke did some amazing follow-up research where they found that the children with this strongest innate number sense, this strongest ability to see quantity, did better in test scores at 3 years of age and later on. And so what we do is we basically strengthen this ability to recognize quantity, strengthen innate number ability, and then we build on a child's math success after that. And very often, you know, if you look at a group of first, second, and third graders, you know, just a group of you know, well, normal children, you'll find that some children have strong number sense. So if you throw down four pens on the table and you say, how many pens are there? Some will glance down and say, oh, that's four. And some children will have to go one, two, three, four, right? Those children have a weak innate number sense. And for those kids, learning higher math will likely be much more difficult because that foundational ability in math is still weak. And so we're basically looking at strengthening that basic math foundation.
And how do you do that exactly? Just through showing them the different quantities?
Yeah, that's exactly right. By showing them different quantities. So I happen to have the highest quantity that we show here, which is 100. So we would start with very low quantities, like 1, 2, 3, 4, and then we work our way into higher quantities. And I know it's completely unbelievable for adults to wrap their head that a small child, right, has the potential of actually looking at a quantity, a high quantity like 15 or 18 or 30, and be able to recognize it, but they can. It truly is amazing.
How do you know that they're recognizing what the quantity is?
So what we do, because these young children are not yet able to speak, we do evaluations by giving them options, right? So for example, if I'm teaching an 18-month-old about different breeds of dogs, right? And if I say to them, what's this? The child's speech may not be good enough to say St. Bernard, right? Or even worse, the child might feel very pressured if they're kind of asked to say it aloud. So what we do instead is we hold up options and we'll say, where's the St. Bernard? Okay. And so by doing that, you know, the children will either look at the answer that they want to select or will grab it. And so if we perform this evaluation over a series of different times, we can start to get like a good enough data set to be confident that the child can do it. Because a skeptic might look at that and say, well, but a child could guess, right? You have two options. They could guess one. You know, you almost have a 50% chance at guessing correctly. But you can't guess correctly 5 times in a row, 10 times in a row, 15 times in a row, right? Mathematically, that becomes almost impossible.
Right.
And so what we do with children is we'll do these kind of very short, what we call problem-solving sessions to evaluate if they're learning the materials.
There's a game that both my kids love that uses a lot of dots, and you add and you look at stuff, and I notice that they quickly can see sometimes, and then sometimes they do count. So when you are saying you need to strengthen that, do you need to say the quantity when you show that? Or
absolutely, yeah. Yeah, that's right. So whenever we're teaching anything, right, we're showing it to the child and telling the child what it is. So for example, now again, when we start with quantities, we would start with 1 through 10, but you would show a fact and say, that's 100, right? Or if we're doing our encyclopedic knowledge program, that's the St. Bernard. So we're combining the visual input so the child can see what it is we're teaching them, and we're telling it to them at the same time. And this is really important because the only way that a child can learn from the world is through their sensory pathways, right? We have 5 sensory pathways. We can see, we can hear, we can feel, we can taste, we can smell. Those are the only 5 ways any of us can learn about the world. And so basically what we're doing with the Doman method, we're taking the arguably the 2 most important pathways, vision and hearing, and we're giving the child that information simultaneously through the 2 pathways.
Does this work for all children? Because I know, I think it's 5 or 10% of the population are kinesthetic learners. And I think the majority are obviously visual learners. So how would that work? Is it still effective with someone who might be a kinesthetic learner?
Some children will learn certain things faster than others. And certain kids also have certain interests more than other kids, right? Some children might be really interested in learning math. Some might be less interested in math and more interested in encyclopedic knowledge, right? And that's natural. And so parents should follow the interests of their kids and kind of, if they start to see that their child has an interest in certain topics or programs, they should kind of follow that with their kids. But yeah, I would say that this program is wonderful for any child.
The dots, it's just simple as you're showing them quantities, mainly in dots. And that's pretty much the way that you're showing them number quantities to build that foundation for math.
Yeah, so that's step 1 in the math program. Mm-hmm. Now, there's an entire math pathway that we follow. So basically, we teach first quantities, then we start to get into teaching equations to children, okay? Because if you know what the quantity 1 looks like and you know what the quantity 2 looks like, then teaching them that 1 + 2 = 3 using those same quantity cards, mm-hmm. that's kind of step 2 in our program. And then we get into teaching them how we write numbers, right? So they can recognize the numerical symbols. So of course, a lot of the things in our math pathway also you would find in, you know, regular math education. We just do it in like a very step-by-step approach, let's say, to keep building on the foundation that the children had. So for example, in my grandfather's book, How to Teach Your Baby Math, there's actually the whole pathway from teaching quantities all the way to teaching algebra is covered. So yeah, we're pretty meticulous about covering all the steps that we can, but teaching quantities is kind of step 0 for how we do it.
Is there a common technique? You have the encyclopedic knowledge, the learn to do math, the reading. Is there one specific technique? It seems like it's all visual based.
Yeah. So first of all, our teaching sessions are very short. Tiny kids learn best when they're taught in fast sessions. And this is one area, right, where it might be difficult for a young child to be successful in a classroom where they have to sit for hours in a day. But Doman method teaching is very, very quick. And when I say quick, I mean 10, 15 seconds in a single session. Oh, and wow. So we move through the materials quickly, and then we allow the child to take breaks and then come back. So first, quick sessions. The second thing is that we do a lot of frequency, right? So for example, if I wanted to teach my child to read the word playing, right? So this is like our reading program, or with encyclopedic knowledge, if I want to teach my child that this is the Saint Bernard, if I teach them that word or that image once, I can't expect a child to learn how to read it or recognize it after one time. But if I do it with repetition, if I do it a certain number of times in a day and over the course of a certain number of days, the children will learn how to read it or recognize it. So often we find if we do something three times in a day for 5 days, so that's 15 total repetitions, children are often quite good at being able to remember it after that amount. So we do short sessions, but we do them frequently throughout the day and over the course of different days. And I'd say the third thing is, it's like a major ingredient in our program is joyousness, right? That parent and child are having fun learning together. That's what we're really trying to do. We're trying to create almost a culture within the family that learning is fun and delightful. And I think, unfortunately, when a lot of, kind of outsiders who don't know much about our work see our materials, they think, oh no, flashcards, it's like drilling kids and it's like miserable learning. Right. But actually, first of all, anyone who says that, I don't think has read any of Glen Doman's books, because he dispels that, right away in any of the books. It's all about having fun learning. And that's because, first of all, the first years of life should be fun. Right? We don't want to add stress to our children's lives, right? That's number one. But second of all, we actually learn best when we're happy and enjoying ourselves. And for kids especially, if you insert stress into learning, their ability to learn actually shuts down.
Right. And I agree. I think a lot of parents, frown upon, oh, they should be playing and they shouldn't be learning anything. And I think I agree with you on the sense that little kids, they really want to learn. My daughter was asking me to read, at 2 years old, she was kind of reading herself and she wanted more help. And they want to learn. But how do you make that joyous for kids?
Well, I think that kids really take the cues from parents, right? So I would say to parents, right, if you love dogs, teach your child about dogs, right? If you love flowers, so I just happen to have some materials lying around, but here I have like different cards of different kinds of flowers, right? So if that's the kind of thing you love, you're going to naturally bring that enthusiasm into your teaching with your kids. And your kids will say, oh, wow, mom, dad are really happy. They're enjoying this. So they're going to naturally enjoy it as well. So I would say, yeah, and just teach your child that learning is fun in general. Kids are naturally curious. They want to learn about the world, right? An average 2 or 3 year old is asking their parents questions constantly, right? Mm-hmm. So much so it sometimes drives parents crazy. They ask amazing questions like, why is the sky blue? Or why is the grass green? Like, these are questions that scientists ask, right? Right. Tiny kids are like, think like scientists in many ways. So if you just, as a parent, think, I'm going to make every moment I can into a teaching moment, and we're just going to have fun with it. That automatically will make the program relax. And I would say if you want to give your child like strict regimented learning, don't do the Doman method, because that's not what we're about.
So tell me, how does a parent get started? Can you get the basic tip? Someone wanted to instill a love of learning and start teaching their child, what would be your top tips?
What we do, we focus on 4 areas of development for kids, right? We focus on cognitive development, mm-hmm. But we also teach about physical development, because physical development is very, very important, actually tied to cognitive development. A lot of people don't realize that a child having an opportunity every day to walk and run, for example, is very, very important for that child's overall development. Running, for example, studies have been done that show that kids who get regular physical activity as part of their school day perform better academically, right? Because physical activity results in certain neurological effects that allow the child to learn better, focus better, and so on. So there's cognitive development, physical development, there's social development, which is, you know, just raising a mature, happy, you know, kind child. And then fourth, there's nutrition, raising a healthy kid. So yeah, we kind of look at it, the child in the whole way, as in a holistic way, because we find a child, you know, to live the fullest life needs all of these areas of their development supported.
Okay, well, thank you again, Spencer, for taking your time and sharing all this information. And I really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, Kelly. I appreciate it.
If you know someone who'd be a great fit for the show, come on over to ingeniousbaby.com and share your tips and story ideas. You are your baby's first and best teacher.